Thank you so much. You can come back anytime and do that. I remember singing this little light of mine in Bible school, but I don't think we sang it that way. And now we'll continue with our sermon hymn, which is on page 29 in the blue hymnal. This is My Father's World. And now I'll introduce John Glass. Many of us already know him. And he is going to present our scripture and sermon today.
Myself together. We'll be reading from Genesis this morning, chapter 1, verses 31 to 24. And God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. On the sixth day, God finished the work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. I want to thank the ladies for that fantastic piece. It was beautiful, and you may not know it, but it's very fitting in, actually, with the whole concept of the Sermon on the Mount, because you remember what we read toward the beginning? Ye are the what? Light of the world. And today we're going to talk about God creating light. And the idea of being light of the world is very central to the meaning of the Sermon on the Mount. But today we're going to go a slightly different direction. We're going to start off by discussing God's character. God's character. What do we know about God's character? Well, what would you say is God's greatest attribute?
Christians have debated this for millennia. Some say it's God's holiness. Other people say it's his love. So I want to take a poll here. Who thinks that God's holiness is his greatest attribute? Raise your hand if you think his holiness is his greatest attribute. I see people going, how about his love? Is his love his greatest attribute? Trick question. Is there anybody who thinks there's another attribute that might be his greatest attribute? Karen and Michael, yeah, a few. Clarissa, you don't count. Nor does Karen. Because they know where I'm going with this, because that was a bit of a trick question. Because I personally believe that his greatest attribute we find at the very beginning of the Bible. In the opening words of the Bible, we find his greatest attribute. What am I talking about? Well, let's look at it. On the first day, God created the light, and he saw that it was good. And then next, he separated the dry land, and God saw that it was good. And next, he created the lights in the sky to light the day and the night, and he saw that they were good. And next, he created the sea monsters and the flying creatures, and he saw that it was good. And next, he created the creatures on the land, and he saw that it was good. You see where we're going? Something, there's a theme running through this. And then finally, after God, and he saw that it was good. And finally, on the seventh, sixth day at the end, we read it, the very first verse, after he created man and everything, he looked around and behold, it was very good. I believe that these verses tell us something about God's greatest attribute, and that is God's goodness. God is good. God is good. That is his greatest attribute, because it's the first thing we learn about God is that God does good things. God's goodness is constructive. It is creative. It is outward flowing. Out of his goodness, he does good things. As a matter of fact, if somebody... Why do we call people good? Because they do good things. If you do nothing, we know nothing. But you do good things and you're known for being good. God is good because he does good things. He created good things. Everything he does is good. So God's goodness also, as we saw, is associated with creation. Not just with creation, but with Eden. We call it Eden, but Eden is actually more complicated than just the Garden of Eden. Because Eden was a place, and in Eden, God created a garden. But we'll get there later. But what we associate with Eden, but not only that, in the Old Testament, you see God's goodness is also associated with the Promised Land. What do you mean? Well, God called it a good land. God called Moses, said, you're going to take Israel, the children of Israel, to a good land that is full of fruit and trees and lovely things. You know what that was? That was an allusion, we're going to see in a moment, to the garden. And not only that, it's associated with the temple. What do I mean? Well, if you read through the Psalms, you'll see this verse.